You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Hey everybody, welcome. It's time for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor once again. My name is Ken Reed. I'm a Boston-based stand-up comedian and podcaster here to talk to you about classic television using back issues of TV Guide magazine from my personal collection as the gateway into our collective past. And my guest this week is the very funny podcaster and comedian Felicia Michaels. Felicia won the 1999 American Comedy Award. She has a great podcast with Joey Diaz called Beauty and Da Beast. I am pronouncing it as it is written. She's been on Star Search. She is really funny, super nice, amazing life story, which we get into in this episode. But if you are unfamiliar with her work, definitely check it out. I always enjoy seeing her. If you are checking out my podcast for the first time because you are a fan of hers, congratulations. You have excellent taste and welcome. This is a very fun show. I enjoy talking to people about our experiences with television. We have about 400 episodes in our back catalog, so please feel free to go back and cherry pick episodes if you see a guest that you are familiar with and you like, or just pick a random one, or you don't have to do that as well. I am totally cool with you doing any or none of that. And also, to be honest, I really wouldn't know if you did or didn't. I am not an elf on the shelf, so please stop spreading those rumors. I am saying it right here on the record. Ken Reed is not an elf on the shelf, so please, please stop publishing that in the National Enquirer and TMZ. Get off my back. Anyway, before we get into this episode here, if you would like to email me for any reason, if you have a question about the show, if you have a guest request, you can do so at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com. or ken@icanread.com. Icanread.com is my stand-up comedy page as well. There's a store on there. Sometimes there's stand-up dates. I go back and forth about putting those on there, but I will try to be better about it. Also have a Patreon, patreon.com/TV Guidance Counselor. I very much appreciate everyone who gives to that. If you would like to give to that, you can do $1, you can do $10, whatever you like. It is hugely helpful and it goes right back into the show, goes into my travel expenses and my posting expenses, which makes it sound like I mailed myself, like the John Cale Velvet Underground song, which I have not done. I believe that song's called The Gift. Very good song. Anyway, I am going on tangent city here. So before I go too insane, let's listen to the episode. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy this week's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Felicia Michaels.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Felicia Michaels, how are you?
Well, thank you for having me.
You're quite welcome. You are B.Y.O.W., which is always good for the show.
Yeah, bring your own water.
Yep.
I had to think for a second, B.Y.O.W.
Bring your own wagon?
Yes.
Yeah, it's always funny because every time I come out here, like to do remote ones, I always, like, the first day, I'm like, I got to stock the fridge because people be coming over.
Right.
And then I always just have a full fridge when I'm gone.
Yeah,
like,
for sure.
Emailing my Airbnb person, be like, enjoy.
Yeah, because everyone just drinks water here.
Yeah. Although the one time I didn't, I had someone come and be like, do you got any beer?
Oh, really?
And I was like, no.
Wow, yeah. That's specific.
Yeah. It was someone who was not, like, they weren't a comic or, like, a performer, really. Uh-huh. So I think they were, like, weirdly nervous.
Yeah.
Which I'm sure you probably wouldn't think of, and I don't.
Yeah.
So you're like, you're nervous?
People get nervous because I do a podcast called The Liars Club, and you have to come on and tell two stories. One is the truth and one is a lie.
Yes, yeah.
People get really afraid when they have to pretend to lie on purpose. People get, I mean, seasoned professionals where they break out in a sweat and you're like, really, dude? Really?
What do they think's going to happen?
Yeah, like the worst thing we're going to say is, oh, that's the lie. Yeah. Like, it's not that big of a deal.
Also, aren't comics just generally good liars?
Yeah, I would think.
The ones I knew were. Maybe yeah. It's only when it's when it helps them that
yes,
they're good
true,
at it.
Yeah. True.
So you immediately kind of picked this issue here from, what is it, December 29th, 1979.
Holy shit.
So the final week of 1979. We're going into the outrageous 80s here.
Yes, wow.
And it's Charlie's Angels on the cover.
Yes, I was formed by Charlie's Angels TV show as a young girl, for sure.
And this is post-Farrah Charlie's Angels.
Yes, it's with the one that was the model.
Cheryl Ladd?
No, Cheryl. Was it? No.
You're thinking Cheryl Teagues?
No, which one is that, though?
So this is Jacqueline Smith, Cheryl Ladd, and Shelley Hack.
Shelley Hack, yes.
She's always the kind of forgotten one.
I know. I think she had, like, weird hair.
Yeah.
She had, like, that kinky, curly hair that they tried to blow out a little bit,
sort of ferret.
Yeah, but it wasn't having it. She had that hair.
It didn't move
when the wind blew.
Jacqueline Smith has... like a Kmart fashion line, I think, still.
You know, I saw Jacqueline Smith. I do a lot of photography as well as comedy. And I was about 10 years ago, I saw she must have been in her 60s, late 60s. And on a photo set, she looks amazing. Yeah. Like, whoa.
I was either last time I was here or two times ago, I was in the Glendale Galleria.
Uh-huh.
And she was doing an event at Sears.
Really?
And I was like, yeah, she looks like she's maybe 40.
Maybe. Yeah. She looks wonderful. And not like in a cut up kind of tight kind of, no, whatever she did it correctly.
She did it right. Her deal with the devil had some good clauses in it.
Uh-huh.
Immediately, and I don't know, you may not have flipped through the articles in the beginning here.
Uh-huh.
But the first article, I'll just show it to you because it's better to see.
The juice is still flowing about O.J. Simpson, right?
It's about O.J.
Simpson. Isn't
that
crazy?
It is absolutely bonkers. And he has a Warhol of himself up on the wall here. And
he's holding a football sitting on a desk.
In case we didn't know
that's
what he was famous for. But I think people forget how famous he was.
Oh, yeah. Like
I think we're used to now people being... infamous, just that's it.
Uh-huh.
But he was an enormous famous person.
Absolutely.
Before he murdered people.
Yeah, absolutely. So crazy.
It's crazy. And sometimes I'm like reminded just seeing something in a thing like this. This issue also, before we get to the week here.
Oh, they had the famous buy 16 albums
for
a penny. Is that what that one is?
This is actually an Encyclopedia Britannica.
Okay, the Encyclopedia Britannica.
Did you have an Encyclopedia second?
No. I grew up poor, so we didn't have Encyclopedia Britannicas.
I also did, but I remember, and a lot of kids I know didn't have.
Or you had the first three because your parents would sign up, right?
Yep.
And then they would come once a month or something, but they couldn't afford past C and D.
And they were still getting collection notices for C and D.
Right.
Like, we sent them to you and you owe us. Or I was always getting, like, they would do things at, like, supermarkets or stuff where it'd be like, oh, it's a 30-piece knife set that you get, like, one a week if you spend whatever. And so we'd have, like, like, the first three of a bunch of stuff.
Right.
Never have a full set.
And during this time and era in 1979, I bet we had a TV that didn't have any picture. The big one was on the bottom, no picture. And then we had a little one on top, little tiny one on top that didn't have, that had the picture and no sound.
Okay.
So you would have to change them at the same time.
Oh, so you had sound and no picture and picture and no sound.
Right, yeah. And of course, the little one that the screen was literally, not very big, but that was the one that had the picture, yeah.
Well, because the TVs, the big console TVs were furniture.
Yeah.
So it was like... well, the TV part doesn't work, but we have this piece of furniture we're not going to get rid of.
Right, exactly. Isn't that crazy?
Weird. It's funny, too, when I think of what I used to consider like a big screen, and it was like 22 inches.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Like, that's like people's
And
phone.
Who had a remote control? No one had a... this is pre-cable in my house.
Yeah.
We didn't have cable.
So you said you moved around a lot. Where were you?
Well, I was an army brat, so I moved around a lot. My mother was from Berlin, Germany. My dad was from Oklahoma. We were stationed quite a bit in Germany.
Oh, wow.
And so that my TV watching as a young person was, or child, was very sporadic because we just had American television.
On the base. Like, they had a...
yeah, so they had like a army something like that. And so I only things I remember seeing a lot were like MASH, because it was one channel that would try to put all three channels into the one channel.
Little so, piece to home.
Yeah. So you didn't get a lot of choice then. I don't remember watching as a little kid that much TV.
A friend of mine also grew up on bases, and he was cleaning out his basement a few years ago, and he gave me, they had a non-US Army base specific TV guide. It was pretty interesting. Because I was like, this is weird.
Yeah.
So then you settled back here when you were a little older?
Then when I was about in sixth grade, we moved to Colorado.
Okay.
And then my stepfather was stationed at Fort Carson. My parents had divorced and my mother had remarried, and we moved to Fort Carson. So that's when the real TV watching began, probably in sixth grade.
Did you feel like you had missed out on a few years of like cultural capital? Like you'd go to school?
Yeah, like when I first started doing comedy and people would make references that I didn't get. Right. You know what I mean? Because I didn't watch a lot of TV because I was always the youngest person at that time in the club. So it was always older people in their, you know, 60s or early 70s to almost this time period.
Right. Brady Bunch, Leave It to Beaver, Gilligan's Island.
Yeah, I think Brady Bunch was on. I didn't watch it maybe a couple episodes when we came right back when it was going off. Same with the Partridge Family. Yeah, all that.
Which is hard because, like, when you started doing comedy, and I'd love to talk to you more about your Star Search experience because I'm fascinated by Star Search. But in that era, that was sort of the first generation of comics I know of that were doing comedy about television. Like, they were latchkey kids, you know.
Right,
so they
right.
were doing impressions yeah. of all these kids, you know, shows we all watched growing up.
And, right.
And so, yeah, I imagine.
Rosanna, Dana, Dana.
Exactly, yeah. Or like, you know, what if Popeye was, you know, or like the Brady Bunch gets one of the Partridge, or
right,
like whatever.
Right.
And it must be really weird to be like, I don't know.
I have no idea what you're talking. Yeah, yeah, for sure. A lot of that.
So 1979, Charlie's Angels, which is a show that I think was mandatory to watch then.
Oh, yeah, please. Charlie's Angels was the shit. Yeah. Oh, my God. I remember watching Charlie's Angels and be like, yeah, when I grow up, I'm going to be a private investigator, and I'm going to have hair like that. I was, yeah, for sure, 100%.
And everyone I know, regardless of gender, seemed to own that Farrah poster.
The hairdo?
Yeah. Like
oh,
the
yeah.
famous sort of, you know,
yeah.
the tank top.
Oh, in her poster, yeah, in the swimsuit. Yeah, yeah. yeah.
Like everyone just had that. It was like a, you're just yes. like, oh, yeah, no, they just gave it out to you. Basically.
Sure, in high school, I had the Farrah Fawcett hairdo. 100. It has, I've had variations of it throughout my adult life. I did once the haircut from Drew Barrymore in The Scream.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, no bueno.
No.
No. It was yeah. Farrah Fawcett or die for me.
Well, yeah, I mean, some people, it's just that you find it works and you go with it.
Yeah, exactly.
And it's funny when I look back at that show too, because it gets not so much anymore, because I think the movies sort of revitalized it in a way, but people used to make fun of it as like a jiggle show.
Yeah.
Which I guess it is.
Yeah, it was totally fine.
But it's fine. Like every woman I know who watched it was like, no, I found it like inspiring.
Yeah, for sure. Because they were doing things that you weren't allowed to do.
Right.
Chase after men.
Right.
Drive real fast in a cool little white Mustang, even though it was the lamest of all Mustangs. Yeah. But you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like it was like, and then what was your favorite character on that?
I was probably a Kate Jackson person.
Yeah.
She was like the bookish one.
Yeah. Yeah.
But could still kick some ass if she needed to.
Right.
But yeah, they weren't like in peril and needed a guy to come save them. Like,
right. Exactly.
It was kind of unusual. There was maybe two shows before that I can think of that kind of fell into that category.
What would those shows be?
You had Honey West, which was amazing.
See, that's the era where I'm like, no clues.
But I don't think Honey West was semi-obscure, but it was Anne Francis, and she knew Kung Fu and was a secret agent, and she had a serval cat.
A serval cat?
Yeah,
what's that?
It's like a little leopard.
Oh, no.
So as a pet, so she was like, and it was like super 60s, like,
right.
You know, she's like a secret agent, and that was a really unusual show.
Yeah.
That might be it. That's like the Avengers, but you have a man and a woman.
Right, before my time. Yeah.
And you have Diana Rigg in her leather case.
Now I know what you're talking about, obviously, but back then I just, didn't watch any of that.
You just have Charlie's Angels?
Charlie's Angels was the bomb, though.
Are there things from that era that you missed that you've tried to catch up on later, or you're like, let's see what this is all about as an adult, and you're like, what the hell is this?
Oh, rewatching the show?
Yeah.
No, I can't say that necessarily, but we didn't have an answering machine,
okay.
The intercom,
right.
Please, the fucking intercom.
Yeah.
That was genius, right? Right? Yeah. And the mystery of Charlie, and you only saw like half his head.
Never see him. Yeah. Yeah. Well, it was so space age to have an intercom.
Oh, I know. Yeah. Like people don't realize, like I remember then when I graduated high school and I finally moved into my own place and I got an answering machine and it was as big as a suitcase.
Yeah.
But I was like, oh, I have made it. Yeah.
I always think it's funny when I see old movies and they have answering services.
Right.
Where you like basically forward your number.
Yes.
And then like there's real humans who take messages. And
they had that in LA probably until 85, 86. Well, because cell phones didn't happen. I think I had a cell phone in like 90, 91.
That's real early too.
Yeah, for sure. I got my first one at one of the first ones that had it. I didn't even know how to use it all the time. It didn't work very good. Yeah.
I remember we had one that was like for emergencies only.
Right.
And it was in the car. And it was in a big zip bag.
Yes.
A gym bag that was all phone. And then
hilarious.
Car phones, which I always thought were funny, which I always associated just.
Mine was maybe more of a car phone.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you could kind of drive down the road. And
it's so funny. Like a few years after I had it, and I did. I think I might have made one phone call with it. And a few years after I had it, maybe even 5 years later, I was living in New York, onto my fourth cell phone.
Yeah.
And when I got something from the cell phone company saying we've been ripping off a big portion of Californians, and they had to give everyone like $1.25 or something like that. Yeah.
Nice. Get a cup of coffee.
Yeah.
I remember it might have been the late 90s, I read a study where they pulled over a bunch of people who were on cell phones and cars.
Uh-huh.
And it was some crazy number, like 80% of them were on fake cell phones.
Pretending to talk on a phone to like, be all like fancy. Thing. Yeah.
Yeah. And I was like, that sounds like an incorrect study. Like, I don't even know where you'd buy a fake
one. Oh, my God. Well, the first cell phone I ever saw in someone's car was probably 3 to 4 years before that. And I had this, I was working, here we go. I was working as a stripper by the airport. And I had this boyfriend, and his best friend was like in some kind of Asian mafia.
Oh, Triads.
I don't know, something like that, right? Because when I first came to LA, I went and I worked downtown at an Asian dance club where it was, they had an Asian clientele, and you would go in and you would sit with other girls in the room, and then they would pick you out, and then you'd just go sit and sip a Coca-Cola with four guys.
Oh, it's gotta be Yakuza then. That's a very Japanese thing.
Well, whatever. But then so he's like, yeah, his name was Lawrence. He goes, yeah, my friend Jimmy's just got out of prison, and we're gonna go meet him. He's gonna, I don't know, pick us up, we something. And he showed up in like an old like 1969 orange cherry Barracuda or something crazy. Yeah, like that,
some muscle car.
Yeah, some crazy and at that point still a vintage car at that point still. And it, and in the middle of the seats he had the thing, and he pulled out a cell phone, and I was like, what kind of craziness is this? Right,
from the future.
I know. Yeah. It was like he just got out of
your friend's a time traveler.
I know. It was so weird.
It's funny when I look back at how often we would get shocked by those things when, when we were sort of coming of age, because there were like milestone things like that. And there's like nothing now that you would be shocked if someone showed you, like, check out this new thing I got. I mean, I can't think of anything that'd be like, oh my God, it's a different world.
Well, I remember being a little girl, and this is in Germany when my dad's stationed in Berlin, and we had a teacher, and it must have been like second grade, and she was like, in the future, they say that everyone's going to be walking around with a phone, and they can walk wherever they want to walk with the phone and talk on the phone, and having the thought of, they are going to have a big ass suitcase in the other hand for all that cord. Like, just not even understanding the concept of not even being able to understand that kind of craziness.
I'm picturing someone like when they have dynamite and they have that reel.
Yes, that's exactly like what I pictured as a kid. Like, what the hey?
I remember it was always a game show prize, especially on Sale of the Century, which might have been my favorite of the 80s game shows. But it was one of those little Sony Watchmen, the little portable TVs.
Oh, and
That seemed like the height of luxury.
Oh, for sure.
And now you can just do that on your phone, even if you don't want to.
Yeah, just some, it's like a Mitch Hedberg joke. Someone will hand you one and say, here, throw this away.
Yeah, that's how.
Because I remember one of the first TV stand-up TV shows I did, they gave those out as little gifts.
Oh, wow.
We were, and they had like an antenna on it, right? And we were literally like, what kind of dark magic is this?
Yeah. We've made it now.
Then I remember when I was first a regular at the Comedy Store, Sam Kinison was a comedian that was very famous at the time, and we were, and he had a big party at his house, and we went to his house, and he had one of the first phones that had a little TV, and you could call someone else, and they were super expensive, and just being like, this is some old bullshit, and you couldn't, because it'd be like all fuzzy when you would watch
black
it.
Black and white and pixels.
Yes, how crazy is that?
I remember there's a series of commercials, I think they were AT&T commercials, and they were around 90 or 91, what's his name? Magnum PI.
Tom Selleck.
Tom Selleck was the voiceover guy for them. And they were all like, have you ever? And it would be some future thing. And it would be like, you will. And AT&T will bring it to you. But they're all almost right.
Right.
Like, it's like, have you ever gotten a fax at the beach? So it's a guy with like a little phone, but like it's printing.
Oh, that's hilarious.
And they're like, have you ever taken a video, like talk to your mother in Germany, but on video? But they're phone booths. Like they're both phone booths. Like, because you couldn't have it in your house. So it's like so close.
So
it's
close. Well, how about this? Blade Runner was set in 2019.
Yeah. And you can go downtown and go to the Bradbury building and it looks the same as it did in Blade Runner.
Right.
But it also looked that way in 1940.
Yeah,
those were like the only things that looked the
same. What they thought was going to happen.
Yeah. That, I mean, how long, like seeing Blade Runner, how far into the future did 2019 sound?
Yeah, it sounded crazy, right?
Like, there's no way we're even going to make it to that.
Or how about when the millennial happened and then it was like the super bug that's going to destroy everything.
Y2K.
Yeah, Y2K. Take care of your Tandy computer because here comes Y2K.
The planes will fall out of the sky. My father had a go bag. He was like ready for the shit to go down.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. And he would like call me and be like, you get your passport? I'm like, Dad, nothing's going to happen. Also,
that is
like,
hilarious.
If I have a bag with water and a passport in it and like planes are falling from the sky, I don't think
you ever bring that up to him later.
Oh yeah. he still is like super paranoid about that stuff.
Oh really?
Yeah, I mean, he's not like a total doomsday prepper, but he bought a mobile home at one point and he was like, you know, just in case shit goes down, gotta go mobile,
right? Oh, like, that's funny.
A lot of people use it for camping.
Yeah.
And he's like, no, you never know. I'm like, okay.
Yeah. That's hilarious.
So Saturday night, what'd you do for this week? December 29th, 1979.
Saturday nights. I didn't write which shows were on Saturdays, but for sure, was it Grizzly Adams on a Saturday?
Grizzly Adams. Good old Dan Haggerty.
I would watch that sometimes because my mom and I were really into animals, so we like Jacques Cousteau, Grizzly Adams, Marlon Perkins. What was that? Marlon Perkins.
Oh,
not Wild Wild Animals.
It was Wild Kingdom.
Wild Kingdom, Mutual of Omaha. I used to have a bit about that because my mom had all these poodles, and one of my first bits I ever wrote was Mutual of Omaha's.
Were they standard poodles or miniature poodles?
No, they were like little ragamuffin poodles.
I got standard poodles,
but
love them.
Oh yeah,
the little minis though—they're very different.
Yeah.
Grizzly Adams was weird. I found Dan Haggerty kind of terrifying.
Yeah, it was a weird thing. Well, that was in the era of a lot of people had beards, like now. A lot of people have beards now. And it's so weird to me sometimes when I see, like the other day I was hanging out with my girlfriend, who I do my podcast with, my best friend, and then a couple of guys that came into the podcast, a guy named Michael Evans, who is one of the on-air producers, all had beards.
Yeah.
It's like, that's weird.
And I'm not a big beard guy. Like,
that's so weird to me.
I was always one of those people that... The album your favorite band did where they all grew beards sucked.
Uh-huh.
I don't want to, you're going through, man, I don't want to be a part of it.
Right.
And they all had that. It was like
Kansas.
Yeah, you're like, oh, it's the Beach Boys beard album. Or even like Black Flag. I'm like, Henry Rollins has a beard. This is not going to be what I want to hear.
Right.
But now they're like, that's like our cultural era as a society. We're in the beard album era.
Right, exactly. Because no one had like a mullet and a beard.
No.
Well, I guess maybe a few people did, but that was a bad combo.
I can't imagine. The only place I would see a mullet and a beard was like in the late 80s when they were trying to depict a punk rocker in a TV show or movie and clearly didn't know what they looked like.
Right.
They were like, it's like a biker, right? But like a little different hair.
Right.
It's like, no, they're not the same thing.
But speaking of Grizzly Adams, I have a vintage lunchbox collection. And I do have a Grizzly Adams lunchbox. And it was a dome lunchbox.
Yep.
Yeah. Which was rare in those days, a dome.
So that's like a lunch pail kind of one, right? Like that's barn sort of?
Yeah, shaped like a barn, exactly.
When did you start collecting lunchboxes?
I started collecting lunchboxes probably in like 90, 91-ish. And my first one, that's why I picked this TV guide with Charlie's Angels, was a Charlie's Angels.
Yeah. Metal, embossed.
Yes, yep. Still have it to this day. And I had like a little strap that I found that I put on it, yeah.
Did you have lunchboxes like that when you were a kid or were you?
I did have. I had, when I was a kid, I had a 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea.
Yep.
And I had a Dr. Doolittle.
Okay.
Yeah.
I've seen that one. There's a place on Magnolia on Burbank, actually.
Yes, I've actually spoken with that gentleman because I just got rid of some of my lunchboxes because I had like 300 of them.
It's too many to display.
It's a lot of lunch, so I had to thin the herd.
And it's funny because I don't even think they really do them anymore, but my favorite thing about lunchboxes is clearly they'd have to press the right amount of lunchboxes for the demand in September when school went back.
Right.
But that's when new shows started. So they didn't really know
which shows
would
go.
Which shows
were going to do good, yeah.
So you have lunchboxes for shows that were like massive failures.
Right.
But they have a full line of like, it's a Mr. Washington lunchbox or like, just bizarre shows where you're like, oh, okay.
Right. I don't mean to correct you, but there was no Mr. Washington
lunchbox.
It wasn't
Mr. Washington. What was the, there was a show that NBC did in like 84 and I can't think of the name now. It was about an orangutan that becomes president and it was called Mr. Something and I've seen lunchboxes
really because I've never seen that.
It's maybe 81 or 82 and maybe it's not Mr. Washington, it's Mr. Something. We'll look it up after.
Okay,
you know.
Okay.
But yeah, so you have these like some weird obscure shows. And most of them are the cartoons where they're the plastic lunchbox with the sticker, which isn't as exciting.
Well, I'll tell you what are the most expensive lunchboxes. And I'm sorry to hijack
about the tangents.
Not the plastic ones like we know it plastic, but they were like cardboard wrapped in shower curtain material.
Yes.
And if you left your peanut butter and jelly sandwich in it a little bit too long, they would mold out and you couldn't really wash them because there's a little hole in it. Than the cardboard would, but I always wanted, because when I was a little kid before we went to Germany, and I do remember watching a show called The Banana Splits.
Yep.
And that was one of those, and the Monkees was also because they were already in reruns.
Yep.
So I probably saw it as a rerun, but they were all made out of that plasticky thin shower curtain material,
the Barbie fashion closet things you'd buy.
Oh, like I had those. Yeah,
it was kind of a similar material.
Exactly the same thing. Yeah. Exactly the same thing.
I remember my parents, we didn't really have any money, and I'd always get like whatever was on clearance from the year before.
Oh, for sure. Yeah.
So one year I had a metal embossed disco lunchbox.
Oh, yes. It's like a purpley looking lunchbox.
And that's not
popular.
They're
like
popular.
In turtlenecks doing a disco move.
Yeah. And I'm like, they got like Coke spoons around their necks.
Right.
I'm like, this is not a popular lunchbox to have in Boston in 1985.
Oh, you must have got
I mean? It was
beat.
I used to do a bit about it, but people would get too sad.
Oh,
but
really?
But I was like, I would get hit with my own disco lunchbox
that's
by other
hilarious.
Kids. And I was like, you haven't been embarrassed in school.
That's what's so funny about collecting lunchboxes is the ones that are always the most well-kept girl lunchboxes, but the boys' lunchboxes just trash.
Oh, yeah. They just kick the hell out of them. You'd use them to hit people with.
Right.
It was a weapon. You have a metal brick in your hand.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like, you're getting your way home from school.
No one looked up the percentage of kids concussed in elementary school before they realized, maybe it's a lunchbox.
Lunchbox. CTE is that's where the thermoses
are. That's hilarious. I know, and then your thermos would break like the first day of school.
Well, remember the glass? A lot of them were glass inside.
Oh, that's why. Yeah.
And which is
how weird.
Giving
a
kid a big glass bottle.
Isn't that weird?
Yeah.
Such a weird time.
Because you didn't have anything else to do with them. But yeah, I have a few. I have a Monsters one.
Oh, yeah. I have one of those.
I'm a big Monsters fan, although I prefer the Addams Family, but I don't think they ever had a lunchbox. Or I've never seen one?
I don't think they did. Now, sometimes they made them like in the 80s and 90s.
The revival stuff.
But they weren't really the launch. You know what I mean? It's not the same. Yeah, it's not the same. Yeah. Because
There was a bunch of Monkees ones, because the Monkees in 86 were huge on MTV.
Right, right.
And they're not as good. They don't have Nesmith on them. Because he had quit by then.
Oh.
And they toured in 86 with just the three of them. And he didn't tour, but he played on the album that they did, which was the one where they're like in a swimming pool. But so it was like the 60s design, just with no Nesmith.
Right.
It was the best one.
Wow, I have to look that up.
It's very weird. So yeah, Grizzly Adams. This one has Tiffany Bowling in it, who dupes Grizzly Adams into tracking down the bear that killed her father.
It was always something like that. Like when I was a kid, we used to watch, as I was older, we used to watch Magnum PI. And I actually do a joke about it in my act, how every week some crazy woman would try to kill her husband on Magnum. It was always younger, beautiful woman, kill her old man, old man. And my mom would be like, oh, that poor gentleman. And I'd be like, what the?
Be like, well, he did all right.
Yeah, I know, so like,
she kills him, whatever. How long were they dating? Or it was always like, my father disappeared. That was the classic. You know, and he's like, especially on Magnum, it was like, how many Vietnam buddies does he have?
It was
like, my father was your Vietnam buddy. He's like, how big was his platoon? There's like 7,000 people.
It was a platoon.
That's true. Yeah. I mean, I don't know anything about army, so I don't know how many people are in a platoon.
Right.
But it could be anywhere from 8 to 500. I don't know. Right.
8 to 500 episodes worth.
What else did you do? Anything else that night, or what'd you have next?
There was Lawrence Welk on a Saturday. So you would start warming up with Lawrence Welk. I mean, you know, my mom liked it, so I would tolerate it, but you didn't really watch it. And then sometimes I think there would be Hee Haw.
Yep.
Hee Haw.
Which I could never do.
Really?
Yeah. It's probably because I'm like a Northeastern snob.
Oh, maybe. But maybe. It,
like, viscerally, that and Mama's Family, when I was growing up, I'd be like, oh.
Oh,
like,
really?
It was weird.
Yeah. Like, I was always into slapstick comedy, so I would like their little sketches. I'm not saying I bragged about it at school, but I guilt watch that.
My dad loves Hee Haw, which he's only confessed in later life.
Uh-huh.
And he's like, the Hee Haw's funny.
Right. I'm like,
this one has Billy Graham on it. Billy Graham and who else is here? Anyone I've heard of? Rex Allen Jr.
Mm-hmm. And you know, I got to go to, I was doing a project and I got to go film at the, I think it's a Buck Owens.
Yeah, the Buck Owens Studios. And is it
Bakersfield?
Yeah.
Is it Buck Owens or is it Roy, the other guy with the short, chubbier dude?
I thought it was Buck Owens.
I think you're right about Buck Owens. But that was kind of like a thrill just from watching Hee Haw. And I have a Hee Haw lunchbox.
Did they have the any of the set stuff still standing?
Oh, no. That's was just a music hall, I think.
Oh, okay.
A performance space.
The Hee Haw lunchbox is just the donkey, right?
They had the fence.
Not the ladies?
They had the fence. You know how they would always have the fence? And then Buck Owens and Roy. Was it Roy Rogers? Roy?
No, it's not Roy Rogers. It's like, I can't think of his last name. And was it, who was the lady with all the price tags on her clothes?
Oh, Cheryl,
Cheryl Pearl? No, not
Pearl.
Cheryl.
Minnie Pearl.
Minnie Pearl.
Minnie Pearl.
Minnie Pearl.
You know, that's probably why I liked it. You know, I really loved comedy when I was a kid. Not stand-up comedy. That wasn't a concept that we knew. I don't know if you know. Yeah. I didn't know as a kid, and especially growing up in Germany and not being around. But that wasn't an era where there was a...
No, just the late night shows.
Like, I remember when I got into stand-up comedy and I told my grandmother and my aunt in Germany, they were like, you're a clown in the circus? And I was like, just culturally, just, you know what I mean? Because it was still a new art form to
and
a point.
And it's very American, too. So it's not like it would translate over there. Yeah, it's funny because, like, when I... The comedy that I loved first was sitcoms.
Yes, and so of course, yeah.
It didn't occur to me that people wrote them. And so when I would start thinking of comedy, I was like, oh, you just have to say the funny thing at the right time when something happens.
Right,
which is kind of stupid.
Well, I remember being a really little girl, and even in when my dad was stationed in Germany, they would run, Laughing was one of the shows that they would run, and sneaking out of my room, crawling on the hallway floor so my parents wouldn't see me, just to look around the corner and to watch Laughing.
Yeah.
And it would always say at the end, film, was it Burbank Studio?
Beautiful downtown Burbank.
Gary Owens. And I just thinking, God, I hope one day I get to see beautiful downtown. I didn't realize they were being sarcastic.
Right. Well, like when I first came out here, I'm like, Burbank's the greatest.
Right. Because
it's like every sort of mid-century thing that people don't look down their nose as much at it now.
No, because cool. Now, and it's kept its own. In fact, we're sitting in Burbank right now, but it's kept its own cool. It still has all the little shops, which is kind of rare in LA.
Which is what everyone complained about in the 60s or whatever. They're like, oh, it's old fashioned. It's funny how those sorts of shows give you a taste for comedy, but you end up doing a totally different form of it.
Right.
Because you didn't see it. So did you first come out here doing comedy or did you just want to move out here?
Well, when I was 18, I grew up on welfare. So, and my parents were divorced and, my mother was handicapped and I wasn't allowed once I turned 18 to live with my mother anymore. Unless she would lose her housing is what the concern was. Mm-hmm. And I grew up in a little town called Fountain, Colorado from sixth grade to about 12th grade. In my senior year of high school, my mother got very sick and I had to go stay with my dad for 6 months. So I barely graduated high school and there was no talk about going to college. So the only way you could stay is if you were going to college, then you could stay. And I wasn't able to. And so I did, because it was a military town, I did what most young women do in a military town. And I married a young GI and then he was very violent to me. So I left and I had no car. I was 20 miles to a place that had any jobs. So I went and did a wet t-shirt contest. On the night that I first did a wet t-shirt contest, I met a stand-up comedian and we started dating. And that's how I got into comedy.
Wet t-shirt contests and mud wrestling were like these huge cultural phenomenons for like 2 years.
No, well, wet t-shirt was longer than 2 years. Mud wrestling might have been about.
But like you would see them in movies where it was like a thing, weird.
That's isn't that crazy? Yeah. And I remember the song I danced to. It was AC/DC's Highway to Hell.
Of course.
Because, you know, theme.
Yep.
And I won $500. And back then, $500 was worth like $1,500.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And I gave my mom a bunch of money for groceries, got my own apartment, and I bought a sweet-ass pair of lace fingerless gloves because it was the 80s.
Yeah, of course. This is the first thing you got to get there.
Yeah, yeah.
Also, I'm like, wow, this stand-up comedian's picking up chicks at a wet t-shirt contest. That's the crazy part of the story.
Well, because there weren't that many. No, because it was in Colorado Springs, Colorado.
Oh, yeah.
And there weren't that many comedians. And, in that area, a few in Denver, they had the Comedy Works, I think, had just opened. But it was like, what a stand-up comedian. Yeah. What the?
In Colorado Springs, by that time, was very conservative.
Oh, Colorado Springs is still somewhat conservative. Yeah. But then it was super crazy. Super conservative.
A friend of mine grew up there and he described it once as if Donald Rumsfeld was a town.
Yes, that's exactly the correct thing.
Cassandra Peterson,
to say.
Elvira's from Colorado Springs.
Yes, yeah. She was already a big star though by the time I was doing comedy.
She left
comedy
when she was 17. But it's funny when I talked to her about it, she was like, it didn't used to be conservative when I was growing up and then they all came in. And so her parents owned a costume shop and it was like a little bit less.
Yeah,
like that, which I never had heard because I always just hear people being like,
yeah, because she was already like 10 to 15 years older than me.
Yeah. She moved out here. Oh, she was the youngest dancer in Las Vegas.
Oh,
and she
really?
Knew Elvis. Yeah. And then she was in the Groundlings in like 77. She was long gone from Colorado, but I never think of her as. And Jello Biafra from the Dead Kennedys from there as well.
Get out of town.
Yeah, he grew up in Colorado Springs and then moved to San Francisco. It's such a weird mixture of people.
It is such an odd little city. Yeah.
That sort of just the way people who have like a creative inclination kind of fly out of there.
Right. And the place I stripped at was called the Peppermint Lounge.
Oh, nice. Yeah. In Colorado?
In Colorado Springs, Colorado.
Cassandra may have also danced there. Because she was like,
she's curious if she did.
It's a very conservative military town. So what I did was I stripped for the very conservative military people because that's what they do.
She for sure worked at the Peppermint.
Yeah, I can't imagine there's more than one.
Wow, I can't believe that.
Yeah, I'll ask her when I see her.
Are you going to see her?
I'll probably see her soon. Yeah, ask her.
Oh, please ask her.
It has to be the Peppermint Lounge if that's the only place. Yeah.
They used to do wet t-shirt Tuesdays and then they did, I think it was just a full on amateur night. Yeah.
Right. Which, I've never been to a strip club before.
Shut up.
Swear.
Really?
Well,
come on. Hanging out with comics? Come on.
That's the thing. I went, when I did the Bridgetown Festival one year, they would do a comics Bridgetown strip club crawl. Uh-huh. And I made it 2 minutes in one and then right. was bored. But that's it. That's like,
yeah.
But my impression of it is a lot of it's not that different from stand up in the. They have an open mic night, basically.
Right.
Like they have
a bringer show.
You know, and they have a headliner. Right. You know, there's a feature right. act, and like right. there's the traveling national, and you're local,
yeah.
and it's kind of obviously not in presentation, but it's kind of like a draws sort of a similar
right.
Thing, or at least it did.
Yeah.
So that doesn't totally make that makes sense. It's not totally crazy.
Let me tell you, being a stripper at that point in my life, a lot when I tell people, sometimes they get that sad look on their face, like, oh,
yeah, I'm sorry you had to do that.
Sorry you had to, you know. But for me, it was getting agency over my own body. It allowed me to support myself. If it wasn't for that, I don't know where I would have ended up. You know, I'm very fortunate. And when I became a regular at the Comedy Store at the age of 21, this is in the era where it was fucking banana cakes at the Comedy Store. And the only reason I was able to hang with these guys is because I had been a stripper for 2 to 3 years already, and I could say, hey, fuck off.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
You were inoculated.
Yeah, I was inoculated from man's bullshit. Yeah. So,
which was the height of bullshit comics.
Yeah, then, because there was so much partying and cocaine. It was the era of Kinison. It was pretty crazy. Yeah.
Yeah, I can imagine. Yeah. And there's not a ton of people left from that.
Yeah, well, they are, but.
Yeah. Or they're not as they used to be.
They're not as they used to be is a polite way to say
yeah,
it.
Yeah, we'll say it that way. What else you got on there?
Well, Love Boat.
Yes.
Was Love Boat Saturday night?
Saturday night it was Love Boat and then Fantasy Island.
Fantasy Island. Oh my God. I loved Fantasy Island.
I always have to read the Love Boat and Fantasy Island descriptions because, A, you never know what guest stars you'll have, which is always like a very exciting thing.
Right.
And the stories are just so wildly different. It's always really funny to see what they put in one episode.
Right.
So this is Love Boat that night. A middle-aged couple played by Barry Nelson and Nanette Fabre, who I don't know, with grandkids.
You don't know who Nanette Fabre is?
No, who's Nanette Fabre?
Wasn't she one of the original Mickey Mouse people?
Oh, is she an original Mouseketeer?
Yeah.
She may have been.
Yeah.
I only know Annette.
Yeah.
And this is with,
I could be wrong.
With grown kids learn they're going to have another. Second story, that's kind of boring. A widower's second wife, played by Beth Howland, tries to win over his daughter. Boring. Gopher's close relationship with his mother. Here we go.
Okay.
Played by Ethel Merman.
Oh, shit.
Leaves his father, played by Bob Cummings, feeling left out. All right. Just the third one seems to be the only one.
Right. Yeah. Well, the Love Boat. Isn't it funny now? Because have you ever done a cruise or been on a cruise or worked a cruise?
But I know tons of people have.
Yeah. But having been on a cruise now as an adult, it's like, what the hell were they thinking?
Because it's just like overweight people eating at a buffet, right?
Yeah. It's nothing like how the Love Boat, like the like when you go on a cruise.
Horny doctors and like disco singles.
Like
and
yeah.
We're in international waters. Yeah. Anything can happen. This is
And then you hear other people who have been on the you like used to it if you worked the boats, the you know, the cruises, that was considered D-class A as a comedian. But now it's like, if you get that gig, that's an awesome gig.
That's one of the few gigs that still pays anything.
Right. Yeah. So you want that gig. But
although it doesn't sound fun. Like, they're always like, and you got to eat with the people. And because you're like the boat celebrity for the 2 weeks.
Right. And but to think about Julie on the Love Boat, where she was the entertainment director, right?
Yep.
And she was like this fun and beautiful lady and all is well. And then you hear from people, and then you got to suck up to the cruise director.
Yeah. So who has like, this power over
it's, to imagine that Julie had the power over all the entertainers.
Julie was just an iron-fisted and then we have Fantasy Island. Let's see if this is any more exciting.
Island.
A famous stuntman, played by Dale Robertson, seeks a reunion with his estranged son, an equally renowned stuntman.
Wow.
And a short order cook, played by Doris Roberts.
Oh, nice.
People know from Everybody Loves Raymond.
Right.
Wants to match her culinary skills with the best in the world.
Perfect.
That's a good one. Abe Vigoda's in this episode.
Oh, Abe Vigoda.
Yeah, I'd be a go on this Fantasy Island. That sounds pretty good.
Remember Barney Miller?
Barney Miller is maybe my favorite sitcom of all time.
Well, when I first came to Los Angeles and I went to the Comedy Store, I wasn't able to get in because I wasn't 21, but standing in line, waiting to sign up in those days, was a guy named Jesse Aragon. And Jesse Aragon had a part in Barney Miller.
Who was Jesse
Aragon? He played like he was a Hispanic fella and he played like a robber or something and they had him in the cage, right?
Yeah, yeah.
But and then we went out on a couple of dates.
So you had seen him in the episode before you met him. Like, did you recognize him?
Yeah, because he wasn't that much. He might have been 5 years older than me or something like that. But just, you know, he probably was like 17 or 18 when he booked the part or whatever. Yeah. But that was like a big thing. And Abe Vigoda. And
Yeah, and it's that show is how I still think of New York.
Yes.
Like, I'm like, yes. The Warriors, Barney Miller.
And the terrible coffee.
Bad coffee. Yeah. Everything's dirty and gray.
And then the Polish guy that was always angry.
Oh, yeah. That's Wojo.
Wojo.
Yep. Wojohowicz.
Yes.
Yeah. He, Vietnam vet. Yeah. And Steve Landisberg,
Who was Mitzi Shore's long-term boyfriend.
Yeah. Who's
Steve Landisberg.
Really funny.
Yes. Didn't know he was a stand-up comic.
Yeah. Yeah. Which makes sense.
Uh-huh.
When you find out later and you watch him on the show, because he has a very stand-up comic
dry delivery.
But yeah, Barney Miller is one of my all-time favorites. I love that show. What else you got?
Disney's Wonderful World. Is that Sunday? We're moving Sunday to Sunday.
Yep. So this was the time when Disney was actually almost out of business.
And then it was like on NBC or something?
Yeah, ABC, Sunday nights.
ABC, okay. Yep, but it was the first show of the night.
Yep.
It was I think before o'clock. Then was Marlon Perkins Wild or Jacques Cousteau.
Cousteau was at 6, which we were talking about earlier before we started recording, how enormous that show was.
Do you know that the guy that was a producer of Jacques Cousteau, the EP, was also the EP of L.A. Confidential?
That was weird.
Yeah, it was, oh my God. I can't remember his name because I knew his son. Anyway, but he was one of the most prolific producers in Hollywood. And at the end of his life, he did L.A. Confidential, but he also did like the 1976 Olympics.
Oh, wow.
He EP'd Jacques Cousteau. He did like, I think, some of the Westerns in the 60s.
Which was not easy.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
EP'ing a show that's like set on the water.
Right.
And it's a documentary or like this. Yeah. That's, you got to have like a general's kind of command of things.
But we loved animals. So that we had to watch Jacques Cousteau every time it was on.
Of the giant squid or whatever it was.
I did. And when, as a young teenager, I wanted to be a marine biologist because of Jacques Cousteau.
I don't think you're alone. I know a ton of people that went into that field for that.
Oh, really? Because of Jacques Cousteau?
Yeah. And it might just be because in New England, we have like the aquarium and there's a lot of that.
David Wolper was the producer's name.
That sounds familiar.
If you want to look it up, he did everybody. Yeah. Prolific.
And they reran them forever.
Oh, yeah.
And a lot of them, nothing would happen.
Yeah, yeah.
It would just be like, we're looking for a thing. We never found it.
Yeah. You think you're going to have this lofty career as a marine biologist, but you're actually just jerking the dolphins off before the show.
Pretty much.
Just, so that they'll so they don't do attack the correct anyone. Tricks.
Yeah. I have a friend. They don't even get to do anything that exciting. They're horseshoe crabs,
uh-huh,
whose blood is blue,
uh-huh,
have some kind of enzyme in their blood that, when you distill it and mix it with human blood, it can detect hepatitis, or it's used for some kind of blood test. So they have to bleed these horseshoe crabs, and it doesn't hurt them. But they basically just collect all these horseshoe crabs, and you know they have a hinge?
Uh-huh.
They have these little things, they hinge them in this thing, and they take blood from them, and they put them back in the water, and that's all they do is a marine biologist.
Well, how do they know it doesn't hurt them? I call bullshit.
Well, it doesn't kill them.
Okay. Well, Jesus Christ.
Yeah, but it's like a human blood draw, you know.
Right.
Not like, they're not killing them and draining them dry.
That sounds horrific.
But I'm like, that's...
Can you imagine you become one of God's creatures and that's your life?
Yeah.
Jesus.
Just because my blood tells you if you're sick, you got to bleed me? There's a really weird made-for-TV movie on this night, and this makes sense as to why OJ was in the issue. It's O.J. Simpson and Goldie and the Boxer, an ex-GI trying to become a champ and a 10-year-old kid trying to stay out of the orphanage. A team like this, you can't miss.
Well, that's like Jackie Cooper when he did as a little kid and his dad was a boxer, right?
And the Kid or whatever it was.
Yeah, and then they redid it with Ricky Schroeder and Angelina Jolie's dad.
Oh, John Voight. Yeah, yeah. The champ. Come on, champ.
Yeah, so this was the shitty TV version of it.
The shitty TV champ. That was the original title. In Wonderful World of Disney that night, they would dump unsold pilots on that a lot. That was kind of what that show became for. And this kind of sounds like one to me. This is called Dad, Can I Borrow the Car? Animation blends with live action in this 1970 pre-energy crunch satire of America's love affair with the automobile. Sequences show a driver education class, a harrowing driving test, a hassle of car buying with a swipe at used car pitchmen, and a convertible's top-down trip through a car wash. It sounds awful. This sounds like someone saw Love American Style and was like, get rid of all the sex, right? Replace it with cars.
Wow. That we wouldn't have watched it that night.
Yeah, that sounds
for sure,
bad.
For sure.
What else did you have on there?
Well, I had Mork and Mindy.
Yep. This is big time. Okay. This episode. It's 60 minutes, first of all. So it's
holy shit.
Full hour of Mork and Mindy. So you know something big's happening.
Was that end of season?
Wasn't end of season. It's I think it's end before the.
Was it a cliffhanger, and then it would give you the answer in the new season?
They have some guest stars in this episode.
Oh shit!
And it's a crossover episode with not just one show but two other shows.
What is this?
Henry Winkler stars as Fonzie, and Penny Marshall appears as Laverne. This one is.
What did they go back in time?
It's the series opener. It's the first episode. Mindy is taken aback at her first encounter with Mork, but nonetheless takes the Orkin in to teach him proper earthly manners. So it's the pilot, basically.
Wow.
But those two shows were so huge. I couldn't imagine how enormous it would be if it's like, wait a minute, this show has Fonzie and Laverne on it?
Yeah.
With whatever these other people
and
are?
And Mork?
Yeah.
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 Wow.
I can't rewatch that show, I found.
Why?
It makes me like weirdly uncomfortable.
Why?
I love Robin Williams, but like he's way too amped up in it. And it kind of makes me like unsettled.
Really?
This probably says more about me. And then also I find...
Are you unsettled because he might have taken other people's jokes to do
it? It's all other people's jokes. Yeah, it's everybody's jokes. No, he's like too unpredictably... Like he seems like a crazy person.
Right.
Because he was.
Right.
And then like... The relationship with him and Pam Dauber is weird because he's like kind of childlike, but it's like a sexual relationship.
Right.
So it's like, it used to creep me out as a kid, but I couldn't quite put my finger
really,
on
it. Really, as a kid it creeped you out?
Yeah, but
really?
I couldn't express why. I didn't know why, but like as an adult, I'm like, I think that's it. Like,
oh, wow. You know what I loved about that show? Just the fantasy of being like a young teenage girl, and it was Boulder, Colorado.
Oh, that's right.
And so I lived in Colorado, so it was like, yeah. You know, with the combination of Charlie's Angels, one day I'm going to live in a really cool old Victorian building and I'm going to have the apartment upstairs.
And I'll have an alien.
And I'll have hair just like her because she had the best hair, right?
Dauber
and she had the
great,
best fucking outfits. Like, we love the Charlie Angels outfit, but come on. I wasn't ever going to be a Charlie's Angel.
That's sex pot stuff.
Right. Yeah. I, at the most, I would have been Pam Dauber. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Pam Dauber could like rock like... flared overalls and a striped shirt and look good somehow.
Right,
like she looks like one of the Zoom kids, but you're like, yeah, it looks good. Love Pam Dauber. What else you got?
We can talk Laverne and Shirley.
Laverne and Shirley.
Let me just tell you the first time I ever remembered a joke and repeat it for the rest of my life was on Laverne and Shirley. So Shirley is making out in the basement in their apartment on a couch with a guy, and the guy's not having it at all. And you know, when Shirley would get all horny, it was funny because Shirley was always prim and proper, right? And so she was crawling all over the guy, and then the guy goes, "What do you want me to do?" And then Shirley says, "Anything but murder, mister." I don't know why I remember that fucking joke, but I was like, yeah. I was like 14-year-old girl, like, you know, my vagina twitched for half a second uncomfortably. I didn't know what was going on. But I was like, yeah.
That's kind of a modern joke. Like, that would work now.
Yeah,
Like a friend of mine was just talking about like how awful dating is. And she's like, well, for a guy, you know, with like online dating and stuff, she was like, for a guy, the worst thing you're like, is I hope she looks like her picture. And then the woman is right. like, I hope I don't get murdered.
Right. Exactly.
So it's kind of like the same thing.
That's
you're like,
hilarious.
You know, that's the more hilarious. Things change, the more they stay the same. More
but
like
I love those kind of jokes. And then there was a show, I want to say it was Scott Bio, but it wasn't Joni Loves Chachi, but it took place in Vegas. Maybe it was Joni on it. But I also remember a joke.
Blanford's Beauties.
It might have been
that. They were all they were all dancer showgirls in Vegas.
Yeah. And there was a joke where this guy was introducing these two girls. This is, I don't want to ruin the joke, but it goes, what are names at Charity and, he had another name.
Faith or something.
Yeah, Charity and Faith. And then the person goes, no hope. And he goes, not for these girls. I don't know why you remember those stupid jokes. How dumb is that?
But they're like, they're classic. I mean, it's a classic joke structure.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
They're also safely edgy. Like
right.
They have sort of a sexual tone,
right.
But they're not like, over, you know, they're not
exactly.
really over the line.
Yeah.
And so it is, as a kid, and those resonated with me too, where you recognize the jokes where you're like, wow, they got away with that.
Right.
You know, like there's a, Newhart's one of my favorite shows, the 80s Newhart. And there's an episode that I talk about all the time, but it's a Halloween episode and it's War of the Worlds and everyone's accusing each other of being an alien.
Uh-huh.
And Julia Duffy's talking about Bob's wife and they're all trying to like throw accusations and she goes, whenever we go into town, she's always buying batteries. She's just like, Stephanie. And I'm like, I can't believe they got that in there because like, it's a really funny line.
Right,
but
right.
like that total, you know, 8 o'clock on a Monday night, like that's,
right.
you know, you get these things in there.
Love those old jokes,
yeah,
for sure.
It's fantastic.
Sure.
You did pass up the Skating Spectacular 78.
Skating was big then.
World champions Linda Fratelliani.
Okay.
And pairs of teams of, geez, Ty Bablionia.
Oh, yes. She was big.
Oh,
that
it's
was
a woman.
Huge.
And
yeah.
Randy Gardner,
yes,
U.S. champions.
Yes, they were a partnership. Yes.
I feel like we need, as a society, we need the on ice phenomenon to come back.
I think you're completely wrong. It was good that it happened. I enjoyed
like,
it, but let's move on.
I feel like that's why people don't care about climate change now.
Well.
They're like, don't make us lose our on ice entertainment.
Right, right.
Like,
that is hilarious.
You better do something or you're not going to have this anymore.
Well, do you remember Robby Benson?
Yes.
Okay,
yeah.
So this is how big I remember the movie Ice Castles?
Yes.
Okay. I was an extra in that movie
really?
As a kid because they shot it in at the Broadmoor, I think, in Colorado Springs, Colorado. There was an ice rink.
Mm-hmm.
I want to say the Broadmoor, which was a hotel situation. And I was in drama class. I must have been like 8th or 9th grade. I think it was 8th grade because I was in junior high. And so they at those times, they would reach out to drama teachers and stuff to get like people to come be extras.
Yeah.
Like I almost was a extra in a Civil War movie, but my mom wouldn't let me go up in the mountains with strangers
right, right,
or whatever.
Right. Just them mountain men.
So we went to go extras, and Robby Benson was such a hottie. And we had to sit there for hours and pretend to clap. You couldn't
right.
touch your hands because they were doing dialogue,
yep.
right? And then we were like, fuck this. And then we left. And then as we were leaving, we came across the food table that they had for all the stars. And
yeah.
we were stealing all sorts
of
food. And then we got caught. And then we had to go home. That's my story about Ice Castles.
But that's your first brush with the entertainment
that,
industry.
Yeah, that I got to see Robby Benson. Absolutely.
Could 100%. Can you see yourself? Have you ever seen the movie? Can you see
never seen the movie because I have a mental block again.
Right. You don't want to.
What about if I saw it and I saw
yeah.
my, you know, 14-year-old self? Yeah.
Nobody wants that for
right.
themselves.
No,
yeah.
I
imagine.
Now I got to go look
like,
at
oh
it.
Oh, my God. See, I would have to look. But, like, my dad... I'm talking about my dad way too much in this episode. I'm sorry. My dad used to always tell me how he was on the Bozo the Clown show when he was a kid with
oh,
my
yeah.
uncle. And they were, I don't know, 6 and 7. This is in like 1962 or something.
Right.
And I found the episode.
Oh, you did?
And I found them. And it was, I brought it to like Thanksgiving one year. And it's hilarious.
Oh, really?
And my uncle, who had become like, you know, he's like 6'7", looked at me, he was like, that's not me, dude. What the fuck? That's not me.
Oh.
I'm like, oh, that's you. Like, he looked exactly like Pugsley. You know?
Oh, that's hilarious.
And, like, so those sorts of things are fantastic to be
yeah.
able to see that.
I should watch it and see if I can. And it was definitely a scene when she was skating in the rink and then she fell and then he came out and talked
yes.
to her on the rink.
Yeah, it's Does a big that, moment.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, see, I was in the big moment.
It's a big moment in the movie.
I have to go look.
Do you remember the movie Fever Pitch that they made with Jimmy Fallon and Drew Barrymore a few years ago?
About the Boston Red Sox.
Where they changed the ending. But a guy who's a comic in Boston is like a real creep, which he wouldn't find insulting me saying that because I think he likes it. But he was always an extra in things.
20 names just flew into my head. Yeah, could be,
none of the old school Boston creeps.
Yeah,
who we could all name. None of the people who think it's okay to say towel head on stage still.
Right.
But so he's an extra in the big romantic scene where they're like, she runs across the field and he's like, they're framing him basically. Uh-huh. And he's staring directly into the camera.
Oh, really?
With this like creepy smile, and it's hilariously takes you out of the scene. It's uh-huh. amazing. Boston, all those guys are still around, sadly.
Yeah.
They're, I think Star Search, you were against someone from, but was it Bob Zaney?
I think he's a Boston Bob guy. Bob Zaney, but Bob Zaney's not a Boston guy.
He would
he's an LA guy through and through. Yeah.
I feel like I would see him in
Because, you know, his first character, Bob Zaney, by the way, very, very, very funny comedian. He was on the Gong Show like when he was 15.
Oh, that's right.
And he was like a surfer comic guy. And now he never does comedy without a suit. So it's so weird to realize that he was on the Gong Show as a surfer comic when he was 15.
I remember, Tim Thomerson.
Yes.
He used to do like a real surfer guy kind of persona. Where he did comedy, which is weird because all his movie roles, he's like a tough guy.
Yeah,
which is really strange.
Funny, right?
Where are we? What else do you have on there?
I have, of course, we can't forget the Dukes of Hazzard. Okay,
them Duke boys.
Seriously, the Dukes of Hazzard, right? Who didn't want to look like a Daisy Dukes in those fucking cutoffs? Right?
It's true, Catherine Bach.
And she had a Jeep. Remember, she had a Jeep.
Yep.
And I was like, yes, yes, I wanted to be a combination between Daisy Duke, Pam Dauber, and Kate Jackson.
I bet a lot of people wanted you to be a combination of Daisy Duke, right. Pam Dauber, and Kate Jackson.
No one at all, by the way.
Can we discuss the phenomenon of this time of Dune Buggies?
Listen, in Fountain, Colorado, I had this friend who had a dune buggy. Like, yeah. Dune buggies were... I just
huge.
Saw one on the freeway the other day, and I was like... And it was all redone. I was like, look at that. Dune buggies.
For like 3-4 years.
How crazy was that, the dune buggy?
And that was like an activity.
Yes.
Like, we're going to go dune buggy.
Yeah, absolutely. What made you think about the dune buggy?
Because you said Jeep, and I was like picturing a dune buggy because it's so 70s for some reason.
And then let's bring up, because we passed Saturday night, but Saturday Night Live.
Yes. Yes.
Saturday Night Live.
So did you have a bedtime where you were allowed to stay up and watch it?
Saturday night you could stay up, but I mean after Saturday Night Live, and coming from a small town, there was like nothing to do.
Right.
But I do remember the first time I ever got high, because one of my best friends, her name was Linda, and this is how weird Colorado was back then. It was kind of weird too. Like there was, even though it was conservative, there were weird little freakish pockets, you know, because usually in an army town, there are like weird little freakish pockets.
Yeah,
like
there's the people, backlash pockets.
The people that got kicked out, right. That were doing not so good things. And
the land of misfit toys area.
Yes, exactly. And so my friend's mom in this little town of 7,000 people on the outskirts of Colorado Springs next to Fort Carson had a weed. It wasn't weed. It was paraphernalia. Mm-hmm. And she called it the head shed.
The head shop.
The head shop. The local head shop. And so as a kid, when her mom would go grocery shopping or whatever, it was our job to sit and watch the head shop. And I remember it was the first time because my friend Tammy had an older sister named Sarah, and she smoked pot, and she gave us weed, and we smoked pot, and we watched Saturday Night Live, and remember the old popcorn cookers that had the big yellow plastic top, mm-hmm. and it would pop, and you could see the popcorn pop,
rising,
right? Right, and we were so high, we took the pot off, the top, yellow top off of it, and we popped popcorn, and we tried to catch it in our mouth during Rosanna Dana Dana, and I remembered that she was, and it was Rosanna Dana Dana, and Bill Murray were on a date, and then he was trying to get on her boobs, and she's like, don't get my, however she did the thing, right? And he'd be like, those aren't boobs, those are mosquito bites.
Oh, it's the nerds. They were playing
the nerds. Okay, yes. And as I heard that joke, I leapt up and tried to catch a piece of popcorn in my mouth. Like, why would anybody remember that?
Because it's those, especially when you're younger, like there are certain flashes of moments that It could be because you weirdly, like, you remember the smelling the popcorn, tasting the popcorn. Right, like, it's such a weird visual aid of all the senses.
With that memory.
But Jesus. SNL was kind of a show designed to watch while you were high.
Right.
Like, and they leaned into it. You know, that's kind of what they, you know, how they kind of got an audience at first.
And the weed was so bad, if I smoked it now, I probably wouldn't get it.
It probably wasn't even weed, to be honest with you.
Yeah, probably. I probably wasn't.
It was actually oregano for the popcorn.
Yeah, but, it probably was 100%.
But, I mean, to your point of you're in this small town, you're probably not getting a lot of, like, even remotely subversive comedy. You're getting stuff from the heart of Manhattan that's like the hippest of the hip.
I know, right?
And everyone has it.
Yeah.
And that's kind of amazing.
And that was also in the era of the Rocky Horror Picture Show.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that whole era. God,
was that happening in Colorado? Like, could
they,
you go?
Oh, yeah. They had the Rocky Horror Picture Show. Yeah, I saw it as a teenager. And it wasn't as big as it was when I came to LA years later. And then it was kind of a revival phase of the Rocky Horror. But then,
it's not quite the same at that
point.
It
wasn't the same. It was just like, this is kind of a weird movie and I'm uncomfortable. And,
yeah, you're like, what is this about? Because it's so 70s.
And 100%. And because Colorado is a very conservative town, I remember being 16 and then I think with Tammy and Sarah, we went to go see the Divine Miss M, Bette Midler's concert
movie. In the bathhouse, right?
The concert movie,
Yes.
And I remember because this is how crazy it was. 16 years old, going to see that, and I literally stood up and I was like, this is just anti-Christian. This is just not, and I left the theater. Cut to 2 years later, I was doing a strip dance Highway to Hell. You know what I mean?
You can blame her for that.
Yes. That's how much you change as a person.
Yeah.
Like, how fucking stupid is that?
But that's, you know, like as a kid, when you grow up with, you're still trying to like find where your values is the wrong word, but where yours sit compared to how it's sort of programmed to you.
Or what attracts you scares you.
Yes.
You know what I mean? Like, you know, like sometimes when you're attracted to something that you're like, oh, I like that. Oh,
I better. This must be wrong.
Yeah.
It feels so red. It must be wrong.
It feels so good.
Yeah.
It must be bad.
But Rocky Horror was, because I was always a fan of like weird horror cult movies when I was a kid. Uh-huh. And, you know, I'd take two buses and a train to get to one video store that had a Eraserhead or whatever. And Rocky Horror you always heard about, but actually didn't come out on video till 1990.
Yeah.
So it was like impossible to see. So I finally got a copy and I was like, what the fuck is this? Like, it just didn't. It's also not a movie you watch alone on video.
Yeah, it's a weird movie.
But I was like, I don't understand what's this all about?
Yeah.
Have you ever seen Phantom of the Paradise? It's a Brian De Palma movie.
Yes.
It's real weird.
Yeah.
But it's the movie that I'm like, this is what I wanted Rocky Horror to be when I saw it. It's like,
here's the thing too. During this time, because my parents had gotten divorced and I lived with my mom, but my dad, when he got out of the army, he went through the GI Bill to learn how to become a movie projectionist.
Oh, wow.
And he bought his own drive-in movie theater in Northern California.
Way to bury the lead here.
I know. And so I didn't get to, I didn't live with my father much as a kid, but I remember there was like a few periods of time. And one of them was when I was like 15 for 6 months because my mom had to go away. And I
don't want to talk about that.
But I had to go live with my dad. And my dad lived on a double wide trailer in the back of the drive-in movie theater with the picture window that pointed out towards the screen. I was just telling someone this story at lunch, and that you would be doing your homework at the same time as Orca would be crashing into the town, right?
Yeah.
And it was such an amazing experience to have that. And my brother used to smoke a lot of weed, and it was his job, because he was like 2 years older than me, to splice the movie reels together, because in those days the reels came in 4 to 6 reels of negative.
Instead of the cigarette burns.
Right. And so, and then my dad had this old beater car that he had, that if he liked a family or if we wanted to invite people to see the movie, we would get to sit in, it was at the very back, and you could hang out with your friends. And I remember I was hanging out with my friends, and we were watching a James Bond movie, and there was a boat scene going down some canal, and it was like dun, 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 dun. And then all of a sudden James Bond is having sex with a woman.
That's the foreplay.
20
the
minutes
boat.
Later when the reel changes, the boat chase again. And you know what,
Someone's
no one complained.
I'm sure sure they didn't. I'm sure they didn't. They were like, you know, it works better that way.
Yeah, it's, isn't that funny?
Have you seen Once Upon a Time in Hollywood yet?
I did. And you know what? Here's the thing that fucked me up about that movie, because that is in the same era that I'm talking. No, that happened
earlier. It's 68, but still. Yeah,
but still. My dad looks like a combination of Brad Pitt. My dad's very handsome. Brad Pitt and Robert Redford. And so he had the same chops and the hairdo.
And he lives in a trailer behind the
And he lives in a trailer. And I was like, what?
That's the first thing I thought of. Yeah. I was like, that must be like, what's happened? What's going on?
And here's the other trippy thing. There was a girl comic named Anna Beta. She's a little bit younger than me. She goes by Gary Anna Abeta. And she was from Fountain, Colorado. And her day job was, she was a projectionist at the local theater in Colorado Springs. She came out to L.A. She is now Quentin Tarantino's personal projectionist down at
the New Bev.
At the New Bev.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's funny.
Isn't that crazy?
It really is a small world with that stuff.
Such a small world.
And the thing I find with, like, those of us that do comedy, especially, like, even though there are some people who I just don't like, but we all sort of have a relatively shared amount of interests.
Uh-huh. Right,
so you get drawn to the same
stuff. Kind of people.
So it ends up being this really small world with that stuff.
And then my dad sold that, and he worked for a brief period of time at Mann's Chinese Theater.
As a projectionist.
And then not only as a projectionist, but they were starting to change a lot of the equipment around, mm-hmm. because things are getting newer and better. And so his job is, he would go to the other theaters and change out the old stuff with the new stuff. And so as a kid, I got to even roam around at the bottom of Mann's Chinese Theater. And remember the Hudsucker Proxy, the movie? When there's a scene in the Hudsucker Proxy where Tim
Robbins
walks down in the basement, and there's just rows and rows and rows of people, right? Mm-hmm. And just rows and rows and rows of receipts and shelving. That's what it was like underneath the Mann's Chinese Theater. They had every fucking receipt since 1923. Yeah.
Well, you never know if you're going to get audited.
Right, yeah. It was such an amazing thing to be able to see that.
Amazing. That's because people don't really know that being a projectionist till probably the 80s, it's actually kind of dangerous, because like the bulbs they would use are really hot, so you had to like constantly make sure things didn't catch on fire. Even before that, like the prints were really volatile. Yeah, and like, you know, you're... it was like a job that really required someone to sit in there and like monitor the whole thing.
Yeah, you had to go to school to learn how to do it.
Yeah. You know? And now people don't care that much. But Quentin Tarantino still has one, which is good. This is also New Year's Day. So there's all the parades, Cotton Bowl parade, you had the Tournament of Roses parade. You know, and obviously the night before was all the New Year's Eve stuff, which... there's like 5 or 6 different rival New Year's Eve shows.
Right.
The big one, of course. Year's Rockin' Eve with Dick Clark.
Yeah.
Here are the guests.
Okay.
Blondie.
Holy
Chic,
cow. Wow.
The Oak Ridge Boys. Barry Manilow.
Wow.
The Village People.
Jesus.
And co-hosts with Dick that year are Aaron Moran from Happy Days and John Schneider from Dukes of Hazzard.
Wow.
That's an all-star cast.
The YMCA.
It's, I mean, we're full disco here.
That is right on the...
Positive Blondie played Heart of Glass.
I remember going to school dance. It was probably that year. And at the school dance, I had a knockoff Kmart Donna Karan dress.
Was it Kate Jackson?
It was a wrap dress.
Right.
And I remember this guy, Patrick, asked me to, I think he's like a geophysicist right now. I don't know what about him. I'm totally serious. And he was like a redheaded stepchild looking kind of guy. And he was, because my mother's German. The thing of growing up in the army is everyone was mixed up. So you're if you were white, your mom was probably German. If you're Asian, your mom's probably Korean.
Right.
Or you were African-American.
What wars have we had?
Right, yeah. So everyone mixed it all up. And so he had a German mother, and so he asked me to the dance, and he wasn't popular, but he was really tall. And no one had really asked me that. And then someone did ask me after he asked me. But I remember going to that dance. I think it was homecoming dance. It was like 2 months before this.
Yes, yes.
And I remember we did the actual YMCA with your arms, or you did the YMCA.
Contemporary.
Yeah, and then I told him I had to go. My mom said I had to go home, and then I went and hung out with the other guy, and then we waited for Patrick to leave, and then we went into the dance, and then like 20 minutes he showed up again, and he was like, oh, and I was like, ooh.
You tried to spare
in
Patrick.
In my Kmart knockoff Dana Carandras.
You tried to spare Patrick, yes. So your heart was in the right place. Right, yeah. You know?
Yeah, what can I tell
but
you?
That's, you literally have lived the classic sitcom two dates to the prom role there.
I did. There you go. There you go.
A few people I know actually had that happen. What else we have on there?
Well, how about MASH?
Yeah. MASH is a show I didn't appreciate as a kid.
Right.
Because it was very adult. But now I recognize how good it was.
Right.
And I'm wondering what it was like for you growing up in an army base.
Well,
like,
yeah. And that was one of the few shows that we got to watch on American television. And so because growing up in an army base and you didn't, you know, you hung out with each other, American kids, even though my mother was German, but it was, you hung out with a lot of older people. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't remember, like, memories of hanging out with a lot of kids.
Because there just wasn't a ton? Or?
Well, there were schools, so there had to have been a lot of kids, but everyone kind of lived in different parts of the city, depending on what your dad did and
right.
what housing project you were in, and then Air Force kids were in a different place, and you did hang out, and then when my parents got divorced, I think maybe this is more the reason, is then we lived on the German economy, because my mother was
right.
German,
so you could.
And so it took a while to get home, and so I was always around a bunch of adults, and I was around army people all the
right.
time. So for us as a kid, for me as a kid, and for my brother as a kid, it made complete 100% sense.
Right.
And my dad had been in Vietnam and was had gotten PTSD and was exposed to Agent Orange. He later on in life went blind.
Wow.
So to us, it was very much, especially my mother grew up, she was born in 1940, and because, like, I remember as a kid, my aunt, growing up in Berlin, was in the middle of East Germany, and so there was a lot of no man's land
yeah.
around West Berlin, and so history was spoken about constantly because they were still living it.
It was still going on, yeah.
It was still going on. So we had, growing up in that experience, a lot of knowledge about war, a lot of knowledge about fighting. You know, as a kid, when my dad, like one of his jobs is he supervised a gun range. So during the summers, we would hang out on the gun range. We handled guns. We, you know what I mean? We were around heavy,
right.
you know, it's deuce and a half trucks.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Kinda,
that was
yeah.
everyday stuff to us.
Is it almost comfortable for you? Like, it's kind of like warm?
Yeah. Like the smell of starch in a uniform.
Right.
It brings me back to my dad. You
right.
know what I mean? Because that, you know, just all those kind of things. So that show in particular was a real touchstone for my family.
Right.
Yeah. So that
That's
was
interesting. Because
yeah.
it's very subversive as well. Like,
oh,
it's,
yeah.
It's
but
not
that
pro
was,
army.
But that was the humor of the soldiers.
That's interesting.
Yeah. Like, I remember as a kid, like in second grade, because we were in Berlin and, we had to take the bus to school, and it was always like the question that adults always spoke about is, will the wall ever fall? Like, my grandfather was actually buried in Berlin, but when the wall went up, they never got to visit his grave after that, and was probably, you know, towed under or whatever. But so that was always the big conversation. And I remember as a kid, this kid on the bus, his dad was an MP, and he was in sixth grade, and they would always try to scare us, like, my dad's an MP. He says the East Germans are coming over on Halloween. Be prepared. Just trying to scare the shit out of us.
Yeah.
So, like, we lived that fear, you know what I mean? And that whole thing. So it was very much a touchstone for
I
us.
I bet. Have you
yeah.
seen Atomic Blonde, by the way?
I love Atomic
yes,
Blonde.
Yeah.
Oh, my
it's
God.
It's a great movie.
I love
yeah.
it. Just because of that.
But that's exactly
like, that's
what I thought
how
of.
I grew up.
Yeah.
And especially because when the wall right came down, I went to go to Germany, because my mom was too ill to travel, and I started doing good as a comedian, so I could afford to go visit Berlin.
Right.
And it was during that era that of Atomic Blonde. I watched
it's
Atomic
great.
Blonde is one of the films that, like, as soon as it comes on, I don't care if it's 2 minutes to the end, I fucking watch Atomic Atomic Blonde, 100%.
It's like a comfort movie.
But oh, yeah.
Then people, I'm like, why are you sitting on this movie, man? This is a fun movie.
That's
like,
a great movie. Yeah. If I ever met a Charlize Theron, I would say Atomic Blonde is like one of my favorite movies.
She's so great in it.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's craziness. That, because the only other movie I could think of is like, there was a movie called Gotcha. With Anthony Edwards, and
he's
like a college student that gets caught.
And Linda he's Fiorentino. Like a spy.
Yeah, but inadvertently.
Yes.
And then whatever the movie is with John Hurt, where they make the hot air balloon to escape. It's called like Night Song or something like that.
Oh, I didn't know that one. Yeah.
It's a true story, but this family, they like secretly built a hot air balloon to get
out of East Berlin.
To get out of Berlin.
Well, see, there's a famous, I'm so sorry to interrupt.
No.
Okay. There was a famous case where, because a lot of people obviously would escape a tunnel under, or they would try to crawl over, and they're in the, of this guy, I think his name was Peter something. And this happened, I would say, early 70s, late 60s or something like that, where he crawled over the fence and they shot him on the east side, and like literally his leg was slung over the fence and he died on the wall, and people couldn't pull him off the wall, and my aunt was a secretary and her window literally looked right at it, and it became a huge thing about the wall at that time.
Because he was not in one place or another.
Yeah, he didn't die immediately. Yeah, he didn't die immediately. So that's why there was always conversations about, like, I knew about the, you know, axis of evil when I was 12 years old. You know what I mean? Because that was the big conversation of, you know, all of that.
I mean, people who grew up in America, we've never had a war here.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not funny, but it's interesting that we'll never, hopefully never, but we couldn't understand what it's like to have that in the streets you live in. And like my wife grew up in England and her parents are World War II babies. And,
right.
You know, it's still constant. It's like, oh, that's where that thing happened and a bomb fell there.
Right.
It's a whole different thing.
Let me tell you, when the wall went down, how many years later after World War II,
90, 90, 90,
and I went over into East Berlin, you could still see the pockmarks from machine gun fire into the buildings because they just had no money to fix things up. If it didn't fall down, it was still usable. Yeah, like you lived that every day.
Every day.
Yeah.
And I went to school in England in the early 2000s, and there were still buildings that were bombed out from World War II.
Yeah.
Like, oh, yeah, that building got bombed, and we just never rebuilt it.
Yeah.
Like, what?
Yeah, I know. Crazy, right?
Because you only see it in movies and that sort of stuff here. Anything else you have there for the rest of the week?
Well, how about Barnaby Jones?
Barnaby Jones was, what's his name from
Buddy Ebsen, who played the Scarecrow in...
he was the Tin Man originally.
And then he was allergic to the metallic makeup. And then he was in...
Beverly Hillbillies,
yeah. Yep. We watched that because my mom was really into crime shows. So we watched that.
Well, there were plenty at that time, too.
Yes, there were a lot of them at that time. And then how about Taxi?
I love Taxi so much. It's such a sad show. And it's the show that I always say, it's a show where, it's the first show I can remember where nobody is doing what they want to be doing.
Right.
They're all like, this is, I mean, it's a night job, but they're like, this is just my temporary gig and I'm an actor, I'm a boxer, I'm a writer, I'm, you know, whatever.
Right.
And it's, obviously I identify with that, as I'm sure most people who do a thing like that does, but that conceit is just gold.
Right. Where,
you know, the people who, it's the life they're having while they're planning, they're making other plans. You know?
Right. The big thrill for me about Taxi is, A, I watched it as a kid because, you know, the wonderful thing about being an Army brat is having grown up in various areas, especially being overseas, is that then when I got stuck in a little town as a kid, you know, from 12 on up, is I knew there's a world outside.
Yes,
that was the gift of that.
You've seen, but it's probably also kind of a curse.
Well, it is a curse because you're not happy with being, you know what I mean?
Right.
I mean, I'm not saying that people can't be happy where they want to be.
No, but you know there's
but
more.
But you know there's more out there. So it's like, to me, it was like, I can't wait to get the fuck out of there. So for me, that show represented like at least trying to live your dreams. And the full circle of that is when I came to LA and I got into comedy and then I won Star Search. And then one of my first TV deals was with this guy named Stan Daniels, who is one of the writers on Taxis. And even though we did a pilot and it didn't get picked up, Dan Hedaya was in it. It wasn't that great of a pilot. it was so great to be able to work with Stan Daniels, who was like an Emmy Award winning writer and one of the creators of Taxi. That was mind-blowing.
Were you like, I'm just asking questions about Taxi all the time?
Or no, because I was too shy. Busy, yeah. Yeah, I was too shy to, you know, even ask him about that. But right. you don't want to glom all over people like, oh my God.
It is. Dan Hedaya is great. He's great in Dick, where he plays Richard Nixon.
Absolutely great. Great actor. I didn't enjoy the experience I had on that set, but it might have been just the situation.
Yeah.
He's kind of a grump.
Yeah. He's an old school. He's kind of a crank. He's an old school, old actor.
He's a crank.
Yeah. It seems like, but he plays
cranks. I'm never going to work with Dan Hedaya. No, he's a fucking crank. But alive. You know what? He's an amazing actor.
Yeah.
He's did some amazing parts. I respect him.
That's someone who would play
a crank.
For a crank. If you're going to play Richard Nixon,
right, that seems the guy to work. Yeah.
Anything else you have on that? Or is that the week?
I think that's it.
Is there anything you watch now? Like, are there any shows that you, like, do you have any comfort shows? I mean, it sounds like MASH maybe, but like that you just throw on?
Oh, God. Not really. I mean, it's hard for me to watch sitcoms because we had the privilege of living through the greatest sitcoms of all times. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So it's, you know, and sitcoms aren't really in favor now. But
no, they're like kids shows now.
And so I can't say that I do, sadly. Yeah. But I collect those lunchboxes.
What are, if you only keep five, what would you keep?
Oh, well, for sure, Lost in Space.
Yep.
For sure, because I remember watching that on reruns as a kid. And then I have a Yellow Submarine lunchbox. Oh, okay. I have another Beatles lunch, those two Beatles lunchboxes. And the reason I love the Yellow Submarine is because before my dad was stationed in Germany, one time they took us when we were little kids. I might have been 3 or 4, 2, to a drive-in movie theater. How weird, right? And but we were supposed to be asleep in the back, and it was for the movie The Yellow Submarine. Mm-hmm. And I remember peeking up over the seat thinking, I should like this because it's a cartoon. I don't know what the fuck is going on.
It's not a kid's cartoon.
I don't know what is going on.
Yeah.
But so this is really weird.
Yeah. So you have a memory of that in lunchbox form.
And probably my Charlie's Angels.
That's a classic.
Because that was my first one that I ever got. So probably.
Cool. Thank you so much for doing this.
Thank you. Sorry I chatted your ear off.
No, that's what it's for. That's why we're here.
There you go. Thank you for asking me. What a fun podcast.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
There you go. That's Felicia. She is wonderful, as you very much heard in that episode. I will put up links to all her social media stuff and her podcast and all the various things she does on TVGuidanceCounselor.com, or you can just Google her. It'll pop up. But if you want a nice, easy place for that to go, you can do that there. Also, if you listen to the show on a smart speaker, let me know. I do listen to it on a smart speaker myself, and I find it very convenient, but it's a little bit of work to get it on there. So I'm just curious what vessel you use to listen to the show. If it's an app or you listen on your computer, that's just interesting to me. You can tweet at me at TV Guidance or at Kenneth W. Reed or on Instagram. Or at the aforementioned email addresses I gave earlier episode. I'm just curious, but you don't have to. It's fine. I hope you have a nice 2020 as we go into the new year, or at least a not disastrous 2020. How about I say that? I hope we all do. But we have a brand new episode next week, and I guarantee you that. So please be here then, and we'll have a brand new episode of TV Guidance Counselor.
You think you're going to have this lofty career as a marine biologist, but you're actually just jerking the dolphins off before the show.